Hello everyone, myself Kiran, a final year undergrad student. Today we have gathered here to discuss about metal additive manufacturing.
Good evening all, myself Tilak Chakravarti and I'm currently doing my postgrad in medical technology at IIT Jodhpur. And today we have Chinoop with us to discuss about the metal additive manufacturing, and we'll also dive into all the topics of the market, what are the 3D printers available today, and also we'll have some questions regarding the area of metal additive manufacturing.
Thanks for inviting me first. Myself, Dr. Chinoop Ayan. I completed my PhD from Homi Bhabha Rashtriya Institute, Rajaramanna Center for Advanced Technology. It's a unit of Department of Atomic Energy. I worked at Laser Additive Manufacturing Laboratory, one of the leading laboratories in India in the area of metal additive manufacturing, who work on basically indigenously developed metal AM systems. So I completed my PhD from there, and now it's a pleasure talking on about the area of laser additive manufacturing or metal additive manufacturing in this book. Thank you.
So let's start about this additive manufacturing technology. Yeah. So when you say that this is going to be a revolutionizing technology in terms of manufacturing, so what do you think its strengths are, and what do you think the advantages that additive manufacturing has over the conventional technology?
Yeah, basically, if you see, additive manufacturing is one of the major pillars of Industry 4.0. You have 9 pillars for Industry 4.0, which are the major advanced technologies, and additive manufacturing is one among them. It is basically the major reason is that there are many reasons, it's mainly because of the freedoms that are offered by the technology. If you say a conventional manufacturing cycle in an industry, it has basically 3 stages. One is a design stage, a manufacturing stage, and a delivery stage. If you see in conventional manufacturing, in design stages, so we'll be having 3 different stages, like a synthesis stage, analysis stage, and a documentation stage. While you come to the manufacturing stage, you'll be having planning stage, raw material procurement, tool part generation, all these things. And the delivery stage is the final, where we check the quality check and we deliver the component. If you bring additive manufacturing to the picture, then we can remove many stages in this. Like, first is the documentation drawing stage after the analysis stage goes away, mainly because we are directly dealing with the 3D model, right? We have the 3D model ready after the synthesis stage, which is going to the FE analysis. At the end, we have again a 3D model. This 3D model can be directly taken to the machine and can be used for the printing. So it happens a layer by layer fashion. And so planning process is also not required, which is required in the conventional manufacturing, because you have to allot the machines and all these things have to be run. Raw material allotment, machine allotment, workmen allotment, all these things have to be done. But in additive manufacturing, all these things will be taken care of by the pre-processing software in the additive manufacturing. So planning stage goes out, documentation stage goes out. Now we have tool procurement and material procurement. Tool procurement is not at all required in additive manufacturing, since we are using, our tool is a laser or electron beam and all these things which are directly embedded in the system and is not going to change with the material and all. Coming to raw material procurement, we are using shapeless materials, right? In metal additive manufacturing, normally we use shapeless materials like wire or powder. So these materials can be procured even before the design is finalized. So raw material procurement is not a hindrance here. In conventional manufacturing, till the design is not finalized, you won't be able to procure the materials, right? So here we have that freedom also. So raw material procurement and tool procurement, all these stages, around 4 stages in conventional manufacturing get eliminated with the deployment of additive manufacturing. So that changes the complete cycle, and that brings a lot of savings to the sectors like aerospace or automotive or other medical sectors, where we have to reduce the time for manufacturing. And one more thing is the different freedoms offered by the technology. First is the shape design freedom. As we know, it happens in a layer by layer fashion, right? So we convert any 3D model, any complex 3D model, into simple 2D sections. So you ultimately simplify the complexity in the model and bring it to a 2D sketch. So the complexity is reduced and we can make any complex structures. So material design freedom is another part, because you can process any material which can be melted and to which the energy source can work on. And another thing is, we can have different materials in a particular layer and different materials at different layers also, because you are doing track by track or layer by layer. So you have the freedom of controlling the composition throughout the build, which is not possible with conventional manufacturing. And another thing is the logistics freedom, because you can design in India and send it to Canada or US where you want to print it. So logistics freedom is another one. Or post-processing freedom is another part where we can tailor our properties as per our requirement, and we can design as per the post-processing requirements also. So these are the different things. And most importantly is the sustainability factor, because we are not removing the material. We are adding the material, and we are just avoiding a lot of material wastage. Ultimately, finally, we need some amount of machining to bring it to the perfect surface, to achieve the perfect surface roughness. But mainly, we are not removing the material during the process. So this is one of the sectors, as Tilak mentioned, that is most commonly, commonly used in aerospace sector. Like, its applications are increasing and it's revolutionizing the sectors, and it's more commonly used in aerospace sectors. The major reason is that the bite to fly ratio is important factor in aerospace, because bite to fly means how much raw material you're purchasing and how much you're converting to actual product is a bite to fly ratio. And typically in conventional manufacturing is close to 10, but by additive we can bring it very close to 1, which is very achievable by additive manufacturing and is very important also. So these are the factors, like you can say the lead time reduction that I initially said, the different stages can be eliminated, the different freedoms that it provides in terms of shape design, material design freedom, post-processing freedom, logistics freedom. So all these are the factors.
Compared to like say conventional manufacturing techniques like casting, how long do you think that additive manufacturing will become a part of, you know, a mass production or something like that?
Yeah, it is becoming a part of the industrial manufacturing sector now also. Like a lot of components, you can see the GE fuel nozzle is one of the examples. A lot of components are coming up in medical sector also. People are directly using the metal component for usage. But the thing is, standards. Standards is a major issue. And now I don't feel like it's going to be long. It's going to take a long time, because now the standards are coming up for different materials, but still it's a long wait, because now the standards have come for many standard materials using laser powder bed fusion based additive manufacturing. So still there are other additive manufacturing processes also, and there are many materials to be used. So it will take some time, and this time depends on when we can develop the actual standards for these materials and for these processes. So, yeah, we can't take a particular time period, we can't say, but this is a major thing that is going to define when we are going to get the deployment of this technology in the industries, because unless the standards are not coming up, we won't be able to deploy it in the sectors.
Sir, you said about aerospace sector is one of the biggest consumer of AM technology currently now, but still, we are not able to develop a technology where you can directly take the additive manufactured part with this microstructure and directly put it into an application. We need a post-processing process like HIP, where the equipment is a bit of a heavy investment from the manufacturer side as well. So in such cases, how do one has to be in the economic part, look into it as an industry where some investors can able to get into and start building up companies?
See, HIPing is required, I agree to it, but it is more of use in laser powder bed fusion processes, where the density is kind of lower as compared to directed energy deposition process. If you see the literature, HIPing is mainly used for powder bed fusion, not for directed energy deposition techniques like laser DED or electron beam DED. So HIPing is not a mass process, if I say for DED process. And yeah, I agree to it that we need post-processing. Post-processing will be majorly based on the machining, because we are not able to get the surface finish that is required for the components, and heat treatment. These two are really important for a deployment of a technology into the application. And the major thing that is going to control, nowadays there are technologies, a lot of research is going on to have in-situ post-processing, in-situ heat treatments, or in-situ machining itself. Even during one of our works itself, we try to remelt during the process itself. When you build the component, we try to remelt during the process itself so that we can reduce the surface roughness. And there are people who do laser heat treatments during the fabrication. So as you suggested, like if you can have a system where we can get the complete product from the machine and which can be directly used for the application, we should have hybrid systems. Hybrid AM systems where we can develop the components, we can machine it, or you do the post-processing inside the machine itself and get a complete component out of it. So hybrid additive manufacturing is one of the hot topics here, where in some systems they have a CNC system attached to the DED systems. And even in binder jetting, we have now seen like people have attached a milling center. So people are doing subtractive plus additive there also. Otherwise, you have a separate laser which can be used for polishing, using laser for laser polishing. So these sort of things are going on. You can have a separate laser for having a heat treatment. So these sort of things are going on. And I think with the heavy research that is going on in hybrid additive manufacturing, whatever Tilak has mentioned is going to come now. We'll be having a direct component from the machine to the application.
When we talk about the various machines available for metal additive manufacturing, what are the major companies which are available in India in terms of metal additive manufacturing?
Yeah. So if I say about the machines, there are basically two types of machines in metal additive manufacturing, or three you can say, but the most commonly used are powder bed fusion, directed energy deposition. The third one is binder jetting, that is also used for metal additive manufacturing. Even sheet lamination, ultrasonic additive manufacturing is also used for metal additive manufacturing, but it's not used in a larger scale. Most commonly used are powder bed fusion and directed energy deposition. In case of powder bed fusion, as we know, like if you have a layer of powder spread on a surface and laser selectively scans and melts the region that is required as per the 3D geometry. In directed energy deposition, we have a laser source which creates a melt pool on the surface onto which the material is added. And we keep it like a pen, like if you have a pen, how we are moving the pen, based on that, we'll be getting a geometry. So this is our pen and you have the laser coming from the center, powder coming from the edges, and you keep it like this and you just move it. So you get a single line. If you move in a circle, you get a circular path. So this is directed energy deposition. So these two are the major technologies. And if I say powder bed fusion is having laser and electron beam as the major energy sources. While in direct energy deposition, we have laser, electron beam, and arc. These three are the different energy sources. In arc-based DED is nothing but a welding setup. You are just extending the normal conventional welding to additive manufacturing. Like you are using GMAW, GTAW to additive manufacturing. So if I say about laser powder bed fusion, the major companies that are working on are EOS, GMPH, Concept Lasers, or SLM Solutions. GE is having the machines. So these are the major players. And in India, should I say about the service bureaus also, or only the machine manufacturers?
Yes, sir, you can mention about them as well.
Some of the service bureaus in India, leading ones are the Intec DMLS in Bangalore or Objectify in Delhi. So these two are main, and you have Rapid DMLS. Like these are the different powder bed fusion service providers in the country. And the major machines, I was said, Renisho is also one. So EOS, Renisho, Concept Lasers, GE, these are the different machine manufacturers. If you come to DED technology, we have Efesto. Then we have Lens, Optomec. Optomec is one of the oldest machines, the first machine you can say from the DED category. POM, POM DMD 3D. So it is by Jyoti Majumdar, Professor Jyoti Majumdar from Michigan. So these three are the major. So, and coming to electron beam powder bed fusion is there and DED is there. Electron beam powder bed fusion, the one and only company that is producing is Arcam. And in DED, they use only wire as the feeding. There is no powder based electron beam DED. There is only wire based DED for electron beam, and it is produced by Siaki. So coming to ARC is not having, like, since it is a welding extension of welding technique, there is no proprietary dealers. So people use the conventional welding setup and extend it to additive manufacturing.
Yeah. Sir, when you look at the market space now, there are players who actually manufacture all these machines. In terms of the manufacturers, where you, a service provider, where if you give the file, you can able to get a 3D printed part of it. In such cases, are companies coming up, and how? What's the rate of companies which are coming up every year? And is the market still had opportunities for people like us, where we are students and we can able to start up a company and enter into the market?
Yeah, obviously. Like now, more players are coming up. Actually, when the metal additive manufacturing started in India, the first laser powder bed fusion dealer was Intec DMLS in India. And now we have many number of DMLS or powder bed fusion dealers in the country, and they are getting a lot of orders, even from private sectors as well as from your government sectors. So the technology is improving, and moreover, as the technology is improving, as the machine quality is improving, you are getting more and more the sectors are the aerospace sector or the medical sector gaining more confidence, and you'll be getting more market. So market is increasing continuously, and the market is majorly dominated by laser powder bed fusion. Even though DEDU, electron beam powder bed fusion techniques are available in the country, in India especially, if you say, laser powder bed fusion is a dominating technology. It is mainly because of its freedom, like to bake complex components. And if you compare with electron beam powder bed fusion, the cost is also less because you don't have to use a vacuum for a laser-based powder bed fusion. So the cost is also less. So mostly, most of the industries, most of the academic institutes, and most of the research labs used laser-based technologies, not the electron beam-based technology. If I can say in India, as far as I know, there is no electron beam-based technique machine available. EB welding is available in many locations, but EB-based LED manufacturing, I don't know. I've seen some of the IITs are developing, but according to my knowledge, there is no available EB systems in India. So majorly, it is dominated by laser powder bed fusion techniques. And yeah, the market is increasing. I forgot to say one thing about the market about the research labs. That is one scope for the students. So since we are saying about the students, I just wanted to say about that also. Research labs who work on metal additive manufacturing, especially, are CGCRI in West Bengal, CMERI West Bengal, ARCA Hyderabad, RRCAT Indore, then you have CMTA in Bangalore. So these are the different research labs. Even DMRL Hyderabad is also having metal additive manufacturing systems. So these are different national labs that work on metal additive manufacturing. So it will be it will be some information for the students who work in this particular area. And I can also summarize some of the academic institutes working in this area, if you can give me 1 second. Yeah, so IIT Bombay is working, IIT Kanpur is working, IIT Madras, IIT Kharagpur, IIT Hyderabad, IIT Palakkad, IIT Bangalore. Then if you say about NITs, NIT Warangal, NIT Trichy. So these are the different institutes that work, and there's some of the institutes. I'm not saying all the institutes, but some of the major institutes that work on metal-based additive manufacturing.
When we talk about metal additive manufacturing, when we talk about the feed or the raw material, let's say if it's in the powder or wire form. So, what are the significance of, being in the form of the, the feed material? And you can also, touch upon the atmosphere, importance of atmosphere in the metal additive manufacturing.
Yeah. So, coming to the feed material, as I said, you have powder and wire. These are the major raw materials or feedstock materials that we use in metal additive manufacturing. If you say laser-based additive manufacturing, wire and powder both are used. And electron beam powder is used. If I say about laser, then in powder bed fusion, you use powder. In DED, we can use both powder and wire. But in electron beam, in powder bed fusion, we use powder. And direct energy deposition, we can only use wire. There is no system available with powder based EDED. And in arc, most of the cases, people are using wire and not the powders. In some of the plasma-based system, they use powders also, but most of the cases they use wire. The major difference is the cost. If you say powder is really costly as compared to wire. And the another factor is the advantage is also advantages of powder over wire is that the accuracy. In wire-based additive manufacturing, normally we use the welding wires and the size of the welding wires is in mm scale. So you are losing the accuracy or controlling, you're losing the control over your precision in terms of like you're going to the minimum mm scale, not on the micron scale. But in the powder scale, normally for powder bed fusion, we have powder size from 10 to 45 micron or 50 micrometer is the powder size for powder bed fusion. For direct energy deposition, we go slightly higher from 50 to 100 micron. The major reason is that in direct energy deposition, we have to bring the powder from the nozzle to the substrate, right? So there is a path through which the powder should flow. So if the powder is very light, it won't be able to carry to the surface of the substrate. Or if it is very dense, or if it is very large, then it won't be completely melting. So you creep a size in such a way that you have to balance both. Either it should not be very light so that it will be flying away, And if it is very large, it won't be completely melting. So you fix a range around 50 to 100 micron is a range that people use there not commonly for direct energy deposition. So even though in powder bed fusion and direct energy deposition, both the scale, you use powders in micron scale. You're not going to the MM scale. So you have the freedom to control your geometry in the micron scale also. But the problem with wire is that, yeah, the accuracy, you're losing the accuracy in that. But at the same time, the cost is less for wire as compared to powder. Another aspect is that in wire, there is no loss of material. If you say in powder bed fusion, okay, yeah, you have the powder bed laid on the surface and you use the laser to selectively scan and melt, right? But you have a lot of wastage of powder, right? Because if you want to make a circle, you are completely filling the powder on the bed and you are just making some circles. Okay, we want to make a cylinder, in fact. Then you are making melting some area only, you are wasting a lot of material. But there are studies that says that you can reuse the powder and there is not much loss of the mechanical properties. And there are some loss in the composition, but there is not much loss in terms of the mechanical properties if you are reusing the powder. But the same time, in wire, there is no loss of material, right? If you see DED system, there is a powder stream coming up and creating a melt pool, and you have a DED system using wire. In powder DED, what happens is that whatever powder is captured into the melt pool is only melting and depositing. You are not capturing the complete powder that is fed. Typically, we use a feed rate of around 5 to 10 gram per minute, and our catchment efficiency, that is the amount of powder captured by the melt pool. If you give 100 grams and how much of the powder is captured with the melt pool, that is around 60% only. So 60 is also on the higher side, I can say sometimes go to 30 also, 30, 20, and it can go up to 80 also if it is very high power laser and all. So it varies in that range. So you are not able, and ultimately you are not using the complete powder that is fed. But in wire-based DED, there is no provision of losing the material. So you have 100% powder catchment, material catchment. So that is a different line. So if I summarize, like in cost terms, wire is better and catchment efficiency type wire is better. But if you say precision and in that side, powder is better.
Sir, as we are talking about the powders, I'm just having a follow-up question on that. The composition which we have to produce the component, and if it has around three metal elements into it, generally we will procure all these elements in form of pure form and then we try to actually manufacture the additive manufacturing component. So what is the advantage in that, and whether this production is where an area where a lot of people are in need? Because I feel that, let's say for example, titanium 6 aluminum 4 vanadium alloy is one of the alloy which is currently being used, where other titanium alloys have not yet been into the market because of the powder production difficulties. So would you like to touch upon that and show some light on that?
Yeah. So here, there are two type of powders that we can use. One is a pre-alloyed powder that comes in the market, and the other one is the powder we mix and use. Like if you say in nickel, we have Inconel 718, Inconel 625, Hest Alloy X, or your titanium 6 AL4V. All these things are commercially available. You can just, it is available in alloyed form and you use it. Otherwise, another option is, as you mentioned, we have powders. So we take it in the different ratio that we require. And we weight as per our atomic percentage, whatever weight percentage what we require. And then we feed it. And it's most commonly used in DED techniques. And powder bed also, it is being used nowadays, but DED is the most suitable technique for that. So you have multiple feeders for that. You put different powders into different feeders if you have individual powders, or you mix everything and put into one feeder. And what happens is in situ alloying happens. You are melting and depositing at the same time. So instead of buying a pre-alloyed powder, you can in situ melt it and deposit it. And this is most commonly used when we have to do some multi-material components or multi-material joints, like functionally graded structures. Like if you want to make some of the works that we have done is like copper stainless steel joint is one FGM that we work on. And another one is copper and nickel. And there are some hard-facing alloys and with stainless steel. So these are the different FGM alloys that we have worked on in our lab. So we try to join them. So in the advantage of mixing and feeding that comes in this particular applications. And coming to other alloy, the availability of alloys, you are saying. So yeah, powder manufacturing is one of the biggest area because in India, the most of the powders are coming from foreign. Even like the big players in the market are Sandvik, Carpenter, Powder Alloy Corporation, PAC. So these are some of the big players in the market for powder manufacturing. And these are all foreign, not Indian-based companies. They're all abroad. So in India also, there are initiatives now. There are some a couple of companies that are coming up in Bangalore. They are working on the powder manufacturing. Yeah, as you mentioned, some of the alloys are not available. In that case, we go for premix powder. We mix the powders and individual powders and we use it. Yeah, but in titanium, I think we have titanium aluminate that, okay, titanium aluminate is also mixed. Then titanium 6L4P, commercial CPTI, commercially pure titanium. These are the commonly available titanium grades. Otherwise, other titanium grades are not much available, as you mentioned. Yeah. But yeah, powder manufacturing is one of the biggest area, and some research labs are also working on it. Like I can say ARCI Hyderabad, they have a good IT manufacturing program and they are working on the powder manufacturing also. So yeah, powder manufacturing is in fact a good area.
Can you share some of your works which you have done in your institute about the additive manufacturing? It would be great.
Yeah, sure. So this is first about, I just want to introduce my institute. So this is Rajaramana Center for Advanced Technology in Indore. We are a national lab working on lasers, particle accelerators, and related technologies. So this is a unit of Department of Atomic Energy and basically work on non-nuclear frontline research areas. And it's also a constitute institute of Homi Bhabha National Institute, a deemed university. And this is a team that works on additive manufacturing at RRKET. So we are this is Dr. CP Paul, who is the head of the lab, who is heading this activity for a long period now. And these are the members and these are the different research fellows in the lab. So I'll just want to show some reference books that we suggest to the scholars normally, since we are dealing with students also. So these are the where we have two books where we have our chapters. So there are chapter 2 in this particular book and chapter 14 in this particular book. And just want to introduce a textbook also that is coming up from our lab, which will be published by Magra Oil, and it's already available in Amazon now. So this is the content of the textbook, and it's basically prepared for UG and PG courses. And it is going to be, say, the commonly, the most common. There is no Indian book that is being used by the Indian university. So this is a one way that we wanted to bring an Indian book, a low-cost Indian book for the students in India. So this is a one initiative towards that side. So I will directly go to the works that we have carried out at RRCAT. So this is one of the work in which we developed a prototype heat exchanger. Like, see if we can show you. So these are different ways we made it. So this is DED technique we used, and we did a lot of research in that, and we developed the program for developing a heat exchanger. We developed a proof of concept of a heat exchanger, a small one. Then we started developing the heat exchanger, and it's a like a 200 by 200 by 200 mm big heat exchanger. Now, this is a cross flow heat exchanger. You have a fluid coming from this side. Fluid coming from this side and another fluid coming from this side. We have to cut it and we have to machine it also. So it's not a complete work, but we built this 200 by 200 by 200 mm cube big structure using DED with cross flow channel. So this is one of the component that we have developed, which is a very recent work. So this is one of the work that we deposited copper. Copper is a very difficult material to process using laser because of the high reflectivity it is having. So we did it. One of my colleagues, Sunil Yadav, is the major lead researcher in this particular work. So we developed a processing scheme for depositing copper, and we then characterized the components and we compared it with the conventionally built structures. This is one of the work we did with NIT Warangal because they wanted to develop stainless steel and its composites. So this is a work that we did here. The lead researcher was Dr. Mr. K. Banerjee, and I'm working under Dr. Y. Ravi Kumar. So they collaborated with us, and we could develop process schemes for SS316, heat treatment cycles for that. We developed the SS tungsten carbide composites, and we characterized. And now we have three publications out of that particular work. And this is a work that we did with IIT Kanpur and IPR, where we developed a copper Ni FGM, and we did work with the IG Corp Alpacom, where we developed another FGM of Delero 50 and stainless steel. And this is one of the works in which we developed. All other works were done on DED system. So this is a work we have done in powder bed fusion system. Like we have, we developed to develop the Inconel 625 process window. So this is how we develop the process window typically for a material. So we have laser power is the, one of the parameter, scanning speed as another parameter, and hatch spacing as another parameter. And we varied the parameters. This is a hatch spacing. So these are, we varied these three parameters and we developed a process window where we can develop the dense structures for the material, and then we characterized it properly. So these are some of the works I wanted to show you. And first of all, I have to show you the system that we used. So this is a system. This is a 2 kW DED based system at RRCAT, which is indigenously developed. So we have, this is a fiber laser that we have. This is operator control. We do the programming here. We have a coaxial powder feed nozzle. So we have a dual powder feeder here, as Tilak was mentioning about the FGMs or multi-material component fabrication. So this is possible with this powder feeder, where we have two dual powder feeders. We have a 5-axis manipulator with a control atmosphere also. We use argon gas for shielding as well as for carrying the powder. This is a powder bed system that is developed at RRCAT. So this is a computer system where we do the programming, we do the slicing and all. So we have a powder spreading, spreading system, a build plate, a controller, Calvino scanner, which controls the movement of the laser beam, and a 500 watt fiber laser. So this is a different systems at RRCAT. So yeah.
Thank you, sir, and kudos to your whole team who has been putting so much efforts in bringing up the textbook for these students. I think, as you mentioned, I too have felt that if there's an Indian textbook available for students, it would be greatly beneficial. And I think all our members who are watching this video could be benefited and can able to check it out in the Amazon as well. Thank you for that, sir. And following with the career prospect for students, sir, like for a bachelor's metallurgical engineering graduate or any other graduate who's interested in additive manufacturing, how he can able to start, you know, getting familiarized with this technology, and in long term, when you look at him after 5 years, what are the things that he has to equip himself with so that he becomes a efficient, valuable player when he goes to any company in terms of additive manufacturing?
See, in terms of courses, if I say after bachelor's in metallurgy or mechanical, even electronics, see, additive manufacturing is really an interdisciplinary area. As you're working on medical, right? So yes, from medical, you have electronics team working on additive. You have a materials team working on additive. You have mechanical team working on additive. So additive manufacturing, anyone can fit into additive manufacturing. That is the first thing. So see, if you see about the, I can say it split up the different activities. Like if you say about the control engineering and all, there are people who can work on the smart structure development, online monitoring of the components. So these are the different part where electronics team can work. There is another aspect where metallurgy, you know, material qualification is one of the important parts in additive manufacturing. So metallurgy is obviously there. Mechanical, yeah, you have to develop the systems, you have to qualify the mechanical properties, you have to design the system. So mechanical team is already there. So if you say about medical, yeah, biomedical application. So there are different sectors that can, different students can come up together and work on additive manufacturing. Coming to the courses in India, after a bachelor's, you can see NIT Warangal is having a dedicated master's in additive manufacturing. And I am one of, I'm part of the first batch of additive manufacturing M.Tech from NIT Warangal. It started in 2014 and I was the part of the first batch. So that is the first thing. And there is a, I think there is a PGDM course by College of Engineering Pune. So that is also there. And I'm hearing that some of the private universities in India is also starting an M.Tech, dedicated M.Tech for additive manufacturing. So these are the things in India, if I say about the masters. And in abroad, there are many universities that provide masters in additive manufacturing or advanced manufacturing. Coming to research prospects, yeah, I can share one slide also for that. So machine or software development, process development and control, materials or feedstock development, design for additive manufacturing, modeling and simulation, characterization and testing, quality assurance and control, application development, education and training. So these are different opportunities in additive manufacturing, if I say. So these are different areas where people can work, and students should be equipped. You should be able to fix which area you want to work on. One is a design aspect. If a mechanical engineer can directly get into the design for additive manufacturing aspect, how he can convert an existing conventional design, how can he tailor that for additive manufacturing? So that is one part. Then, as I mentioned before, the metallurgy people have a lot of opportunity in terms of the material development, characterization, how to qualify the process. Even physics team, the science background people have a lot of work that can be done in additive manufacturing, because if physics people can work on the process physics that is happening here. So there are opportunities of physicists, there are opportunities for chemistry people who can work on the different alloys. So there's an immense opportunity that is going to come. And students, yeah, I should say that they should be ready to take up any work. Like, as I mentioned before, it's an interdisciplinary area. So the advice for students will be that you should be ready to take up any particular work and you should go ahead with that. So like if a mechanical engineer is there, he should be able to take metallurgy. A metallurgy engineer should be ready to take up electronics. So in that way, interdisciplinary work is the one that can take additive manufacturing to the next level.
Thank you, sir. That was concisely put into a very good way. And so, sir, is a post-grad as well as doing a PhD in additive manufacturing would be also a better choice for the students?
Yeah, definitely. Like if you have additive manufacturing master's or a PhD, then you have, see, in India, you have a lot of companies coming up in additive manufacturing, a lot of research labs coming up in additive manufacturing. So you have a lot of opportunities coming up. One more thing is a foreign opportunity. So in foreign, in abroad, the technology is in another level and you have a lot of opportunities there also. So if you can have a master's or a PhD from India and you can have opportunities abroad, or you can complete a master's here or go abroad for a PhD. So there are different ways like you can go ahead, but yeah, completing a master's and PhD in additive manufacturing will be really great. So that in that particular course, you'll be learning a lot of aspects. And it's only not about additive manufacturing. You have to learn a lot of skills like materials, powder metallurgy. A lot of things are involved, as I mentioned before. So you have to ready with your skill set.
Thank you, sir, and for spending your time with us and giving us a very valuable insights upon metal additive manufacturing. I think we, personally, I felt very valuable after the conversation and the kind of things, especially when you talk about the industrial revolution and what are the things that is required and how additive manufacturing is simplifying the whole process. I was really astonished and I could able to give a sense that it is going to be the future where everybody is have to come up with different technologies and being interdisciplinary and starting with the next level. So thank you for spending your time with us, sir. Really, okay,
thank you very much.
Thank you,
Kiran. Thank you, Tilak, for this opportunity. It was a great opportunity so that I can share my thoughts with the students or with everyone who is subscribing to this. So thank you very much.